Happy New Year, Binghamton, and welcome to a special roundtable 2015 Focus on the Tier. I'm Greg Michael. Tonight, we are going to take a look back at some of the key stories that occupied our news headlines here in the Southern Tier, and I will lead a conversation on how their impact may carry forward into 2015. We'll discuss fracking, the casino bid, our area's incredibly burdensome property tax, the continuing heroin battle, and how our local leadership is, or not, addressing the mental health needs of the region. When we return from the break, to frack or not to frack, was Governor Cuomo's decision to end the debate, or are we just getting started? Governor Cuomo's decision caught many by surprise. We went from fracking being the region's savior to the state's highest court empowering local municipalities, now to a full statewide ban. But the debate continues.
I think this is a very factual presentation and persuasive on the facts. Do I believe the facts will trump all emotion? No.
I've invited Doug Garner, a professor at Broome Community College and a member of the board of the National Issues Forum, as well as Bob Joseph, the host of WNBF Radio's Binghamton Now program that can be heard weekdays from 9 to noon on News Radio 1290, to join me as part of the roundtable conversation on the program today. Bob, let me start with you. Has the governor's decision ended the debate?
Hardly. In fact, the discussion will continue probably in court for months, maybe longer. You just don't know how much longer this could go on. People think that the way the governor made that decision would put an end to that chapter. Unfortunately, this may be just the start of a new chapter.
Doug, the governor of Maryland, also a Democrat, oddly enough, looked at the same research that Cuomo and his administration looked at, but came to a completely different decision. It makes one wonder, begs the question as to, is the research accurate?
I don't know whether the research is accurate. It'll probably take years to know for sure. I think part of this was a political decision. Having come from downstate, I have come to understand upstate-downstate divisions. And I think this is a factor. There is also a very strong environmental presence, even in upstate New York. This area has had environmental problems over the years. So it's not surprising that even in this community suffering economic disaster, that some people would take an anti-fracking position.
What do you expect to hear on this topic in 2015? Either you, Bob, or Doug.
Well, I think we're going to wind up hearing from the supporters of fracking. In fact, they have a rally that's planned in Binghamton, and it's one thing that they haven't done in the past. They haven't held their own rallies to as great an extent as those who were opposed to fracking. In fact, they're having second thoughts, I think, on the way they conducted their efforts over the last several years. Some people are saying they should have taken some of the pages out of the playbook of those who were against fracking and actually had a greater effort to go out where Governor Cuomo was. Remember, the people opposed to fracking were basically bird-dogging Cuomo at all of his appearances. Every time the governor would appear in Broome County, it was in a carefully controlled environment, usually on the Binghamton University campus, so he could always be separated from the protesters who were against fracking. Now, if the people supporting fracking had done the same thing, there's a chance that the governor may have paid more attention to their point of view.
So more of a political football this had become, more than an economic issue for the governor.
Despite what the governor said. The governor had always said he wouldn't allow politics to get involved, that it would be all left up to the science. Well, a lot of people still think that politics ultimately was a key factor, including many of the people who support Governor Cuomo from downstate. They believe that they ultimately were able to sway his opinion, despite the fact that the governor tried to make it sound as though it was all left up to his health commissioner and the commissioner of environmental conservation.
It's an interesting point you make. In Zucker's report, now Howard Zucker, the New York State's acting health commissioner, in his report it says here that, quote, a guarantee of absolute safety is not required for him to come to the conclusion, for the committee to come to the conclusion in order to greenlight fracking, that is. And he acknowledged, again, I quote, absolute scientific certainty about the safety is even unlikely to be achieved, which leads me back to the question, Doug, about how the state of Maryland looked at the same research but came to a positive decision, whereas Cuomo came to a negative decision, looking at that same research.
I still don't think it's an issue of dueling scientific studies. Mm. I still think, as Bob has suggested, there's much more in the political realm that factored into this decision. One other thing, if you're looking forward to 2015, I think that for the people who were supportive of fracking, you're going to see a lot of legal challenges.
So it'll be a more of a legal challenge going forward in 2015 that versus the protests and sort of the community pulling together.
Well, to look at it another way, there were two big hopes for the area. One was fracking, one was the casino. If he delivers on the casino, or shall I say the gambling commission delivers on the casino, then you get half a loaf.
Well, I want you to hold that thought, because when we come back from the break, we'll pick up on our next topic, and the next topic will be that casino. So stay with us, and we'll be right back after this message. No casino for the Southern Tier? Don't bet on it. Now the former rivals, owners of Tioga Downs and Traditions at the Glen, have been brought together by Senator Libous to pursue an unawarded fourth license.
I have talked to Senate attorneys, and we are going to ask for a rebid in the Southern Tier District for that fourth license.
On Friday, Cuomo the politician came out, wrote a letter to the Gaming Facility Location Board, and asked for them to open up the process for this fourth license. Bob, what's behind this letter?
Well, it is clear that the Southern Tier is hurting, and a lot of people have come to the conclusion that with fracking off the table and with no casino for the real Southern Tier, that something needs to be done to help in terms of economic development. And apparently, that's what Governor Cuomo is now saying. At least that's his public position.
Well, you know, what I found interesting, those of us here at Fox 40 got a hold of the actual letter. It was publicly made available. And in this letter, Doug, he writes, and I quote, exciting national competition that may submit an even better than the applications were received in the first round. Is that a shot at Tioga Downs or a tradition?
Read the last sentence, though, where he suggests that the Gaming Commission needs to expedite and move quickly to a solution. I don't know how you could have national competition on the one hand
and move quickly.
Have the Tioga Downs entrepreneur saying, I can be ready to go in 90 days.
And that was the point that Jeff Gural of Tioga Downs had made from the very beginning, that his facility, because so much has been done, including the racino that exists now, plus the recently completed garage, they could have that up and running in a matter of several months, and that would be a rapid turnaround if Gural wound up getting the license.
You know, all these are good points, but what I want to ask, Doug, is the casino the answer? I can ask the same question about fracking.
For the economic renaissance of the area?
Is this the right way to go with either issue?
For 100 years, the area was dominated by Endicott Johnson and IBM, two major industries. Small-scale entrepreneurs, I think, will be the future of this area. How did fracking and, you know, the casino fit in? I think it could be part, but it's not going to be.
We have Chobani in Norwich, New York. I mean, these are the type of businesses that we want to spark into the region. I mean, on the small business scale, we have some tremendous microbreweries, not that I frequent them often, but I do on occasion. You know, the Galaxy Brewing and the Binghamton Brewery, which just opened up a few months ago. You know, it's nice to see these type of businesses, because we're putting so much emphasis on fracking, we're putting so much emphasis on the casino. It just, and your university built out a casino management program. So it makes me wonder, our leadership, if how we are creating the right incentive.
We have a $300,000 gambling casino lab on our campus. You know, there are other things that we could look at. One of them might be retrofitting houses to make them more energy efficient. There are all sorts of incentives you could use. Development of renewable energies that...
It would be nice to see our leadership start to change that
exactly.
Focus a little bit. And when we come back after this break, we're going to talk about another issue that's plaguing the area and seeing how our leadership is handling that. Stay tuned, and we'll be right back after this. No fracking, no casino, yet property taxes remain among the highest in the state. However, townships are stretched in being able to provide basic services.
We're going to have to find ways to cut even further. And our residents suffer, our employees suffer, the whole town suffers.
Now, Bob, Binghamton Mayor David claims that the prior administration raised taxes a whopping 52% over the prior 8-year period. Can that change?
Sure it can change. And Mayor David now is in a position to change that. I'm not sure that it's easy, and I'm not sure that it's constructive to point fingers at his predecessor, but now Mayor has an opportunity over the next 3 years to get taxes under control. It's going to be a big challenge.
No doubt. And some politicians, Cuomo included, Doug, have advocated for consolidating services, yet voters are leery of such a thing and would never embrace such an idea.
Wherever municipal consolidation has been considered in the southern tier, it's been rejected. Same thing with school districts.
And but why do they keep going back to it?
Because they think they can save some money. If you have one superintendent for the entire Broome school district,
right,
like Fairfax County in Virginia has, instead of 12, you're ahead of the game.
But you know, to me, this tax issue is not just necessarily a Binghamton issue, it's a statewide issue. And what's amazing to me is that in 1930, we've had 45 seats in the U.S. Congress representing the state of New York. That fell to 41 seats in 1960. We have since lost even more seats in 2010, if I counted right earlier this morning, to 27 seats, and it's continuing to go in the wrong direction. We have a graphic that we just put up on the screen showing that New York recently lost, in the last census, 14 seats. Where does this leave us going forward, gentlemen?
It means we're going to have less and less power in Washington, less influence. Look, California, Texas, and Florida now will have much greater influence in Washington than the state of New York. And the trend is likely to continue. The only good thing right now is number 5 is Illinois, and the gap between New York and Illinois is significant. So we're going to be number 4 probably for at least the next couple of decades.
Well, while we have to pay our taxes here at Fox 40, we have to pay our bills. So we'll be right back after this to talk about another issue that we're facing here in the Southern Tier in 2015.
There is a technical issue.
The next topic is difficult and frustrating. Heroin use, especially among Binghamton's youth, continues at epidemic levels. And in August, the state authorized distribution of a potent heroin antidote, naloxone, or commonly referred to as Narcan, to SUNY police. What's amazing to me about this is that the state released it not to the police, but to SUNY police, campus police. Doug, you being on a university, what's the history here?
Well, we hired a criminal justice chair back in the late 90s, and he hadn't been on campus more than maybe a month or two, and he observed that there were drug deals going on. He had been the police chief in Arizona, or New Mexico. You know, I mean, drugs are very common on college campuses.
How do we put a dent in it? I mean, it's grown, Bob, as you know, to epidemic proportions in this region.
That's true. And even with Narcan, not just on campuses, but out in the community right now, we've had more heroin-related deaths in 2014 than in 2013. I haven't heard the exact number for 2014, but 2013 was over 30. And the number of deaths in Broome County exceeded the 2013 number. And it's just out of control. And it's not unique to the Southern Tier. It's the entire state. Actually, it's the entire country. And last year, the governor of Vermont made heroin the sole component of his State of the State message. It was that serious in Vermont. We didn't hear Governor Cuomo say much about it in his State of the State. I expect that this month we'll hear more from Governor Cuomo about the heroin problem.
Who's leading the charge here in the state, and what can we expect from them in 2015?
Well, we have a special panel that's been set up. I mean, the work is underway at the state level, but as far as I can tell, over the past year, not a whole lot's been done except allowing more police agencies, more fire departments, more EMS crews to have access to Narcan. That's good at dealing with people who are overdosing and hopefully saving some of their lives, but it doesn't get at the
problem. And Doug, when we are sitting here next year at this time, will there be much of a difference?
It's hard to know, but we talk about Narcan. There's another drug that's very useful, Vivitrol. This is a drug that's taken once a month for people who are addicts. And unlike methadone, which you have to take on a daily basis, if you can go a month, you can have proper counseling to help you learn how to deal with those demons. If this drug were used on a far greater scale, it could have a real positive impact in helping people.
Impact is the key here, and I agree with you, Bob, that we're addressing the end stage of this problem, and we need to deal with the root. And when we get back, we're going to deal with one root of an issue that has come up here in the Southern Tier that we need to be vigilant of in 2015. Stay with us when we conclude this look at the Southern Tier. One last topic I'd like to discuss. Fresh on our minds is the brutal slaying of two police officers in New York City. Well, here in the Southern Tier, we had a similar experience earlier in the year with Officer Smith and Trooper Skinner. The reason? Mental illness, and we're closing facilities. No one expresses his concern better than one of our own from right here in the community.
The test of a society is how the poor and the vulnerable are being cared for, and we seem to be going down a slippery slope here.
Bob, is this another victim of poor funding from the state?
That's part of it. And part of it has been a long-term change in the state's policy as far as deinstitutionalization. Over the years, thousands and thousands of patients who were housed in the psychiatric facilities have been released, and in theory, it should be better for them. But if they don't have sufficient services in the community, then they're at risk, and to a degree, people in our communities are at
risk.
Well,
it's sufficient services that I want to probe, Doug. Arthur Johnson, who is Broome County's mental health commissioner, has indicated that by closing the facilities, the other services will be able to pick up their load. And Fox 40 was able to get a letter today that United UHS has written to Arthur Johnson, actually saying that please don't close the facility because they can't handle their load.
A professor, a colleague of mine, has a son who's in need of such services. He was told by the group that was going to pick him up that he wouldn't be able to see a doctor, I think, until early January. Bottom line is, they said we had 500 people that we're now having to deal with, just too great a load. And if you miss an appointment, you're cut off the program.
Yeah. And Bob, where do you see this going in 2015?
Well, it's going to be an ongoing problem. The question continues to be whether Broome County wants to support adequate services with its mental health clinic. Also becomes an issue of state policy, whether changes can be made, whether the people who benefit from mental health services can actually have their voices heard. Sometimes I think the problem is they don't have a group that really has a strong voice, whether it's in the Broome County Legislature or in Albany. They don't have the type of lobbying organization that gives them the voice that they really need.
You know, I think mental illness is something that is a very difficult thing to discuss. It's a very difficult thing that all of us have to face, whether it's with loved ones or those of friends of friends. So I understand the state has snubbed us with a casino, killed fracking, lowered Medicaid reimbursement as it relates here to the mental health clinic, and causing the close of clinic. Taxes are rising and forcing people to flee New York. And in 2015, what do we expect?
Well, we might expect more of the same. Question is whether people want to come up with new solutions and stop blaming people who made decisions in the past. Easy to look back, but all those decisions have been made. Now it's time, in my view, to look forward and come up with new ideas, and ideas where people can reach a consensus.
All the more reason for having citizens meet in maybe small groups, tackle particular issues. That's one of the things I'm involved with Public Deliberation National Issues Forums Institute. You need to re-engage
the citizens. Come and be a part and listen in.
Of course. I mean, I think you need to re-engage the citizenry and say, this is your community. Don't blame it on this stakeholder or that stakeholder. You need to step up too.
You know, I think if not for the strength and the resilience of the people in the southern tier, I'm not sure where we would be today. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Doug. I hope if I'm able to host future roundtables, you'll consider coming back and maybe we can probe some of these issues a little bit deeper. And on behalf of all of us here at Fox 40, thank you for tuning in, and feel free to join the conversation by contacting us here at Fox 40 via email or on our Facebook page, or even check out this program on YouTube. I'm Greg Michael. Good night, and may 2015 be prosperous and healthy for you and your family. Fox 40 sends out a Happy New Year greetings to the residents in by Marriott and Vestal, and thanks for their promotional consideration for tonight's program.